Now the next chapter is chapter number 3, viral replication. Unrevealingly, the complexity of the virus replication is a central focus of much of experimental virology. Studies with bacteriophages in 1940 and 1950s provided the first insights. With the development of mammalian cell culture method, the technique used for the study of bacteriophages were adapted to animal viruses. Progress has been such that the basic mechanism of the transcription, translation, and nucleic acid replication have been characterized for all major families of the animal viruses, and the strategies of the gene expression and regulation has been clarified as well. Our knowledge of the virus replication continues to grow in complexity. It was easier to generalize when we know less, but now we know that every family of the virus employs unique replication strategies. One important unifying and simplifying concept as originally proposed by Davis Baltimore in 1978 is to assign all viruses to one of the six classes based on the composition of their genome and the pathway they used to produce their mRNAs. This is in the picture 3.1. This chapter presents an overview of the subject, indicating similarities and differences in replication strategies adopted by viruses of each family that contains pathogens of animal. Further information is provided in the viral replication section of the chapter in part 2. Now comes to the viral replication cycle. 1-step growth curve. Most studies of the replication of the animal viruses has been conducted using cultured mammalian cell growing either in the suspension or in the monolayer adhering to a flat surface. Classic studies of this kind defined the one-step growth curve, in which the cell in a culture are infected simultaneously using a high multiplicity of infection, and the increase in the infectious virus over time is followed by sequential sampling and titration. This is in chapter figure 3.2. Viruses that is free in medium can be titrated separately from viruses that remain cell associated. Shortly after infection, the inoculated virus disappeared. Infectious particle cannot be demonstrated even intracellularly. This eclipse period continues until the first progeny virion become detectable some hours later. Non-enveloped viruses matures within the cell and may be detectable for some time as infectious intracellular virions before they are released by cell lysis. Many enveloped viruses, however, mature by budding from the plasma membrane of host cell and are thus released immediately into the medium. The eclipse period generally range from 2 to 12 hours for viruses of different families. Early studies relying on quantitative electron microscopy and assay of infectious virions provided information about the early and late event in the replication cycle, that is attachment, penetration, maturation, and release, but not about what happened during the eclipse period. Investigations of expression and replication of viral genome become possible only with the introduction of biochemical method for the analysis of viral nucleic acid and proteins. Now all of the sophisticated techniques of molecular biology are being applied to this aspect of the infection processes. So there are two figures you have to see. Now, event during eclipse period. Figure 3.3 illustrated in a greatly simplified fashion the major step that occur during the eclipse period using adenovirus as an example. Following attachment, the virion enters the cell and is partially uncoated to expose the viral genome. Certainly, early viral genes are transcribed into RNA, which may then be processed in a number of ways, including splicing. The early gene products are translated from the messenger RNA, mRNA, of the three main types: proteins that shut down cellular nucleic acid and protein synthesis, proteins that regulate expression of the viral genome and enzymes required for replication of viral nucleic acid. Following viral nucleic acid replication, late viral genes are transcribed. The late proteins are principally viral structural proteins used for the assembly of new virons. Some of these are subjected to post-translational modification before use. Maturation occurs in the nucleus. Each infected cell yields thousands of the virions that are free to infect other cells. For most DNA viruses, transcription and DNA replication takes place in the cell nucleus using cellular RNA polymerase second and other cellular enzymes. Most RNA viruses replicate in the cytoplasm, and because cell lacks enzymes to copy RNA from an RNA template, either the viral genome must itself function as mRNA or the virus must encode and carry its own RNA polymerase to transcribed RNA from the RNA genome. Next is attachment. In order to initiate infection, virons must be able to bind to cells. Binding occurs between ligands on the surface of virons, this is virus attachment proteins, and a receptor on the plasma membrane of the cell. Too often the illustrations used to describe this interaction makes it seem too simple, but there are many variables, and in vivo there are many different ligands receptor pairings. In fact, the lack of correlation between the attachment studies in cultured cell versus intact animal may be seen as an indication of this complexity. For example, with the herpes virus, several viral envelope glycoproteins may serve as attachment protein and several cellular receptors may be involved. In sequential order, the first achieving a loose attachment via one receptor, then irreversible binding via another. This multiple set attachments phenomenon provides redundancy and also facilitated the need that the herpes virus have to invading epithelial and neural tissues so as to support the latent and recrudescent infection cycle. Recrudescent, latent or recrudescent, RECRUDESENT. Other viruses do the same, although there is a degree of specificity about the recognition of particular cell receptor by particular viruses. Quite different viruses, that is orthomyxovirus and paramyxovirus, may utilize the same receptor, and conversely, viruses in the same family or genus may use different receptors. All in all, viruses have evolved to make opportunistic use of a wide variety of host cell surface proteins as their receptors. In most cases, using receptors, cellular proteins that are crucial for fundamental cellular functions, such as cellular proteins, are strongly conserved over evolutionary time so that the viruses are rarely caught out by failure to find their favorite receptors. The cellular receptor for most orthomyxoviruses in the terminal terminal sialic acid on other oligosaccharides side chain of a glycoprotein or glycolipid exposed at the cell surface, whereas the viral ligand is in a cleft at the distal tip of each monomer of trimeric viral hemagglutinin glycoprotein. The receptor for a number of other viruses are member of immunoglobulins superfamily, such as ICAM1, intracellular adhesion molecule 1, which is a common receptor for the many rhinoviruses. In the best studied receptor ligand interaction of all, that the human cells and human immunodeficiency viruses, HIV, attachment initially involves the CD4 molecule on the surface of target cells, notably macrophages and T helper cell lymphocytes, via the viral GP120 envelopes glycoprotein subunit termed SU. The CD4 SU complex then bind to a second cell receptor molecule called fusin, FUSIN, which when sprung MOUSE mousetrap TRAP mousetrap fashion displaces the SU subunit and brings the transmembrane TM subunit into direct contact with the cell membrane. A fusogenic domain of transmembrane subunit then brings about the fusion of the viral envelope with the plasma membrane of the cell, permitting the viral nucleocapsid to enter the cytoplasm. Receptor ligand interaction in other lentiviruses infections are similar. Next is uptake. Following attachment, virions can enter into cells by one of the two mechanisms, receptor-mediated endocytosis or fusion. Receptor-mediated endocytosis. The majority of mammalian cells are engaged continuously in the receptor-mediated endocytosis for the uptake of macromolecules via specific receptors. Many enveloped and non-enveloped viruses are viruses use this essential cell function to initiate infection. Virion attachment to receptors which cluster at a clathrin-coated pit, CLATHRIN, clathrin-coated pits, is followed by endocytosis into clathrin-coated vesicles. Vesicles enter the cytoplasm and after removal